Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining in today. Reclaiming Braj for the Vallabh Sampradaya, Art for Pilgrims of Nathdwara, 1900 to 1930. Before I start with this presentation, I would like to begin by thanking Dr. Parab for giving me this opportunity to speak to this knowledgeable group and Dr. Dravid for introducing me to this group. Dr. Goswami Gokulnath of Mota Mandir, Mumbai has been a great resource person, and I would like to acknowledge my debt to him too. I have divided this talk into five subtopics. The first is importance of Raj in ancient Bharatvarsh, concept of Raj is the second one, the centrality of Govardhan to the sect, shift to Nathdwara, and painting in the late 19th century and early 20th century. As we go along, you'll understand why Vraj is such an important thing for aspect for the sect. Vallabhacharya, 1479 to 1531 CE, founded the Sampradaya, also known as Pushti Mark or the Path of Grace, at the end of the 15th century. It is informed by the Bhakti Mark, Path of Devotion, and its etymology is received from the 10th chapter of the Bhagavad Puran, which locates Krishna and his leelas in Vraj. Vrajanti gavo yasmin iti vrajah, which as per the dictionary Katre 1969 page 337 means to go, to walk, to proceed, implying movement and motion. This area roughly corresponds to the Mathura district in modern-day Uttar Pradesh. This intersection of mythology and geography has come to create a locus for the Pushti Marg within the framework of thousands of tirths in Bharatvarsh. Now, the importance of Vraj in ancient Bharatvarsh. Puranic literature considers Mathura to be the birthplace of Krishna and Gokula to be the home of his foster parents, Nand Baba and Yashoda. Excavations carried out in the area have brought to light ancient pottery and painted grayware, which points to early inhabitation of this area. They have revealed the importance of the Nag and Yaksha cults during the 1st and 2nd centuries BC. Buddhist and Jain sculptures also have been found in abundance. The earliest sculpture of Krishna is known from the Kushan period, 2nd century CE, which shows him in the pose of lifting Govardhan Hill, now in the Mathura Museum. A larger corpus of sculptures showing Krishna in various leelas are known from the Gupta period. There is little or no evidence of prevalence of a Vaishnav cult prior to this period, and no literary evidence that Mathura was a Hindu site of pilgrimage in the early historical period. It does not appear in the list of the Mahatirths. Also, very little is known of the history of the Mathura region between the 7th and the 11th centuries. However, the plethora of Shaiva imagery and relics lead us to believe that Shaivism may have been the predominant religion before the advent of Vaishnava saints in the 15th century. Among the earliest Vaishnav saints to visit and live in Mathura and Vrindavan region was Madhavendra Puri in the late 14th century. He was Chaitanya's grand guru and was responsible for installing the image of Gopala, more famously known as Srinathji, in the village of Anyur at the foot of Govardhan. Vallabha called this icon by the name of Govardhan Nathji, while Srinathji was the name given by Gokulnath, the grandson of Vallabha. Since the early part of the 16th century, this region became a major area of Vaishnav pilgrimage, and Govardhan Hill, along with the 12 vanas, came to constitute the 84 course parikrama. David Haberman believes that both Chaitanya and Vallabhacharya journeyed through the vanas of Raj. For the Vallabhans, the journey is documented by Gokulnath, the grandson of Vallabha, in the 84 Baitak Charitra, which narrates Vallabha's year-long journey in the region of Raj. It is believed that the yatra was formalized by Vitthalnath, the son of Vallabhacharya, and Narayan Bhatt, a disciple of Chaitanya, in the mid-16th century. There are some differences in the course followed by the two sects, but by and large, they follow the same routes. There is a close connection between the Pushti Sampradaya and the Chaitanya Sampradaya, and that will also come out as we go along in this talk. Three of Vallabha's 22 baithaks in Braj are concentrated in Gokul, where under a chonkar tree on the banks of the Yamuna, Krishna is supposed to have revealed to Vallabha how the jeev can be saved from the cycle of birth and rebirth in Kaliyug. Vallabhan Goswamis and devotees are regular performers of the 84 course parikrama. Idea of Vraj. Vraj is a sacred landscape best interpreted as an area shaped by the way of seeing the divine. In nature and physically engaging with it through ritual activities. In this landscape, natural archetypes, that is mountains, rivers, vegetation, symbolize the axis mundi, a link between earth and the heavens, where divine encounters are most likely to occur. Over the centuries, pilgrimage routes evolved around those natural features where devotees such as Madhavendra Puri, Vallabha, Chaitanya, and Narayan Bhatt experienced visions of the divine. This was augmented by inputs from the senses and is explained by the Sanskrit term darshan, meaning to see and be seen, which encompasses the range of physical, mental, and spiritual engagement implicit in this act of seeing the landscape. Narayan Bhatt writes of Vraj in the Vraj Bhakti Vilas. Vraj is the very form of Krishna, and this is very important, because Vraj actually comes to denote Krishna or to represent Krishna. For the Bhakt, every stone that has been touched by Krishna's feet, every tree, every vana has been Krishna's playground, where he cavorted and unfolded his vilas with the gopis. Vraj is an encounter between the body of the pilgrim and the body of Krishna. Vraj, as a natural phenomenon, is not a symbol of divinity, but a metonymic divinity. It's a metonymic divinity in itself. The very earth of Vraj is known to be a moksha karak. The Vraj mandala is, and I will show you the Vraj mandala now. Here is a is a map of the Vraj Mandala. Unfortunately, I have not been able to get a very good close up to it, but as we go along, you'll be able to probably see the ones and ponds that I am talking about. This is Vrindavan here in yellow. And this is a route of 7 days that takes place. What happens is that they do this Chaurasi Coast Parikrama, and this is the whole Chaurasi Coast ki Parikrama that takes place, very much like the Narmada Parikrama or some of the other Parikramas that are prevalent in Bharatvarsh. The Vraj Mandala is considered an essential form of Krishna, consisting of organs and limbs of the Lord. 12 major vanas have been identified and designated by Narayan Bhatt, and the Vallabhans accept it along with the Gaudians. In his discourses, Sri Sukh narrates in the Bhagavatam how the gopis, Jiva, identify each stone, each tree, each water body, every creature, be it insect or animal, with Krishna, who is the Paramatma. In short, divinity in multiplicity. The idea of this yatra is to experience this concept. Mathura is considered the heart. Madhuban, the navel. Kumudvan and Talvan are the breasts. Vrindavan, his brow. Bahulban and Mahaban are the arms. Bhandiraban and Kokilaban are his legs. Khandiraban and Bhandrikaban, the shoulders. Chhatraban and Lohaban are the eyes, while Belban and Bhadraban are the ears. Nandanban is the head and Indraban is the back. There are other buns too, but I have limited it to the important ones. We can see here the primordial concept of Purusha being inflected on this landscape. The centrality of Govardhan. Within the framework of Vraj, the focal point is Mount Govardhan, which is also considered an anthropomorphic form of Krishna and is revered both by Vallabhans and Gaudians. According to Gaudian tradition, the icon of Srinathji was located by Madhavendra Puri at the end of the 15th century. In the Gaudian tradition, the legend narrates how Madhavendra Puri was meditating in the village of Anyur below Mount Govardhan when a young cowherd approached him and informed him that he was the one, that no one in the area fasts and then disappeared. At night, the same boy appeared in his dreams and led him to a bower in the nearby forest. The boy revealed that he resided here, suffering in the rain and cold, and that he was Krishna, Gopala, the one who supports Mount Govardhan. He then instructed Puri to take the image out of the bower and install him in a temple. As instructed, Puri took the lifelike image, excavated from the bower, and installed it in a temple in the village of Anyur. He then organized a large Annakoot fest to be offered to the deity. After 2 years, he had another dream that instructed him to go to South India in search of sandalwood for seva of the icon. Leaving the service of the idol in the hands of some Bengali priests, Puri proceeded to his peregrinations and did not return. I would like to really talk about one small darshan that they have in Nathdwara now, in the month of May, where they actually bathe or actually cover the statue of Srinathji in chandan, ground chandan, to cool him. And probably this has some kind of harking back to the act of the Bengali priests praying to him or performing his service, number one. Or number two, to the idea of Puri being sent, Madhavendra Puri being sent to the south to bring back Chandan for the seva of Srinathji. Now here we have an image of the Pratham Milan, which is the first meeting between Srinathji. Here, if you see my cursor, the meeting between Srinathji and Vallabha. Here is the cow that was feeding milk to the image of Srinathji, which was in the ground. You will understand this legend as we go along and I explain it to you. Vallabha legend narrates how Vallabha located the image, having received divine guidance to the icon through dreams. According to Srinathji ki Prakriti ki Varta, attributed to Hariran, the great great grandson of Vallabha, the image was first discovered by Sadhu Pandey, who tracked the icon through a missing cow that emptied her udders. Here you have that. Others on an object that looked like an iconic form, probably a Naga image. 69 years later, on the day Vallabha was born, the face of the image was revealed miraculously. Sadhu Pandey was instructed to continue feeding milk to the image. When Vallabha appeared at Govardhan in 1492, he is supposed to have unveiled the image to the world through the dream that he had. He was able to locate Srinathji. He now installed Govardhananathji on a pedestal and offered him solid food for the first time, which the icon received. Puranmal, a rich merchant, then helped finance a temple atop Govardhan to house the image. In Vallabhan, in the Vallabhan account, it was Vallabha who appointed some Bengali priests to perform seva and then left. So can you see the connection between the seva with sandalwood and the Bengali priests then being continued probably in Nathdwara? These priests then performed for seva for 14 years before they were evicted by Krishnadas, a follower of both Vallabha and his son Vitthalnath, with the help of Mughal officers Raja Todarmal and Birbal, and set the homes of the Bengali priests on fire. This is the first documented instance we encounter in the growing tensions of the two sects in Raj. The seva during Vallabha's life was relatively simple, but broken into ashtadarshans or eight darshans according to the eight prahars of the day. It is Vitthalnath, his son, who is known to have designed the elaborate rituals we see in Nathdwara with music, food, incense, elaborate and expensive clothes and jewels, all designed to please Srinathji, the child Krishna, in the stance of lifting Govardhan. He also gathered the works of eight poets known as the Ashtachap Kavis, and their works are sung during the eight darshans set to Drupad and Dhamar, which have become famous as Haveli Sangeet. From here, we go on to the shift to Nathdwara. In 1670, Srinathji started a southward journey to ostensibly avoid the marauding armies of Aurangzeb. But modern historians feel this may not have been the only reason for the move. The Jats in the Doab area were showing signs of rebellion against the Mughal Empire. There was intersect rivalry between the Gaudians and the Vallabhans, and also royal patronage that Vitthalnath enjoyed had dwindled. To secure themselves, Tilkayat Govardhan Lal, 1655 to 1704, and his uncle Govindji decided to move the image to safer ground. They moved from Govardhan Hill first to Agra, then Kota, Bundi, Kishangarh, Jodhpur, and finally to Sihar in Mewar in 1672. A period of 2 years elapsed before a final home was settled for the icon. Norbert Peabody has shown that the decision to build a permanent haveli in Sihar, now Nathdwara, was based on concessions of land and revenue from 25 villages received from Maharana Raj Singh of Mewar that tilted the balance in favor of building the haveli in Nathdwara. Interestingly, the haveli of Kankroli, also in Mewar, was established 2 years earlier by the family of Vitthalnath's third son. Legend gives us to understand that the wheels of the cart carrying Srinathji got stuck in Sihar, and therefore it was understood as Srinathji's will to set up his haveli at this spot. Another legend has it that Srinathji would come from Govardhan to meet his sakhi, who was a princess of the royal house of Mewar. He promised her that he would make his abode in Mewar in later years. Paintings in the late 19th and 20th century. We fast forward to the late 19th century. History had changed. Pan-Indian politics in Mewar was subject to state, subject state to the British Crown. Patterns of trade and industry changed in the country due to the Industrial Revolution in England and Europe. The coming of the steam engine and the opening of the Suez Canal changed the world order. Bombay and Calcutta became preeminent centers of trade and commerce in India. And a new merchant class amassed great wealth in these cities. A number of these merchants of the Bhatia, Lohana, and Marwari community owed allegiance to the Pushtimal, contributing to the havelis at Nathdwara, Mumbai, Ahmedabad, and other centers in Western India. They actually paid a lag or a religious tax to the Goswamis. Also, you know, what you can see is that there is almost a divide. The country is almost divided between the Gaudian Sampradaya and the Vallabhan Sampradaya into two, where you have a major following of the Vallabhan Sampradaya in the western part of the country, and the east has a greater following of the Gaudian Sampradaya. With the wealth amassed by the Maharajas, some of the Maharajas lived in great style, and Giddharji, 1843 to 1903 of Nathdwara, actually sided with the forces of Tatya Tope in the great uprising of 1857, forcing the Maharana to exile him from Nathdwara under political pressure from the imperial government. Giddharji's son, Govardhan Lal, 1862 to 1934, was appointed the Tilkayat, although still a minor. Another scandal broke out in 1862, famous in the annals of legal history as the Maharaja libel case, where Jadunath Maharaj of Mumbai was accused of depravities and excesses. These events brought down the fortunes of the Sampradaya, and Nathdwara had a downward spiral in terms of its fortunes. It is to Govardhan Lal, who took over as Tilkayat in 1877, and some of his contemporaries, that the credit of the resurrection of the Sampradaya is due. The temple town we see today is largely from the days of his stewardship. He saw an opportunity in adversity. His strategy was to bring in as many devotees into the temple town and have artisans of different mediums settle in Nathdwara. To achieve this, he devised new darshans, jhankis and festivals, which brought more devotees to Nathdwara. The new railhead also helped travel from commercial centers to Nathdwara. The most famous festival was the Panch Swaroop Ka Utsav, where he invited four other swaroops for seva. It was at this time that art for pilgrims took a new turn. The cities in Western India, especially Bombay, became the cultural capital. Art schools promoted Western art styles along with theater and Western music. Western imports like prints, textile labels made their ways into the popular consciousness. Ravi Varma was another major influencer of popular taste. Also, Maharana Fateh Singh, 1846 to 1930, sent Master Kundan Lal, an artist from Nathdwara, to study at the Slade School of Art. Merchants, the new elite, who were influenced by the West and Western aspirations, demanded novelty in the art they sought to adorn their homes and their memories. A new modern style of painting emerged at Nathdwara. These paintings told legends that belonged to the Varta literature of the Sampradaya or the Leelas of Krishna as narrated in the Bhagavad Puran, and drew on Western painting styles. So here we have some of the subjects of the paintings, which we will discuss now. The first is sectarian literature, which are the Vartas. The second is from Seva or Darshan in the temple. The third are images from the Bhagavad Puran. And the fourth category are the popular legends, which don't have a place in the Bhagavad Puran, but are popular through Krishna Leelas and itinerant theater. So here we have Pratham Milan again, and here I'd like to point out once again Krishna and Vallabha out here. Here is the cow, and here is Sadhu Pandey. Sadhu Pandey, who is showing his friends that the cow is emptying her udders on the icon. Here is another legend of the discovery of Navneet Priyaji and how he was discovered and brought into the temple of Srinathji. But I have not gone into that because we have concentrated mainly on Krishna and the other areas of. So again, this is Pratham Milan. If we compare this painting to the earlier one, we see how the artist narrates the same story, but in a more realistic manner. Govardhan here appears as a mass of boulders, which is it is actually, and it is shown realistically by the artist. The village of Anyur at the foot of Govardhan also gets perspective, while Yamuna is represented in front, which completes the entire essential elements that are needed to depict Raj. This is the legend of the birth of Vallabha. This does not occur actually in Raj, but I have brought it out because it is important as a sectarian legend. Although this does not occur in Raj, it's an important myth in the Sampradaya. Vallabha's parents, Lakshman Bhatt and Ilamma, fled Kashi on the threat of the raids by Bahul Lodi on Kashi. On the way in the forest of Champaranya in Madhya Pradesh, Ilamma gave birth to what was supposed to be a stillborn baby. Leaving the baby behind under a tree, the parents proceeded with their journey. The next day, in his sleep, Krishna informed Lakshman Bhatt that the child was alive and well. The parents returned to the spot where they had left the child and found the child encircled with a protective fire, unharmed by man or beast. Since then, Vallabha is considered to be an Agni avatar of Krishna. On the same day as Vallabha was born, the face of Srinathji revealed itself at Mount Govardhan. Therefore, he is also considered the Mukha avatar of Krishna. By Mukha avatar is meant that he has the authority of Krishna to preach Krishna's philosophy. This is another leela from the Sampradaya, which is known as Kandara leela. It's a sectarian myth that shows Vallabha to have had a vision and performed seva of Srinathji in the same cave that Krishna stood in when he lifted Govardhan. Here, Vallabha performs seva of Srinathji along with Swaminiji or Radha. There are various interpretations by artists of this particular legend. One of them, which shows the presence of Vithalnathji also, along with Yamunaji. And here on top, you can see the first temple of Srinathji that was built by Puranmal. And here you have Yamunaji right in front. And of course, the ubiquitous peacocks, which are found all over Raj. And you will find peacocks throughout paintings of Nathdwara of this period. Now we come to a selection of darshans that have take place in the temple. This is the first darshan of the day, called Mangala. Here, Mahaprabhuji is shown as Vallabha is also known as Mahaprabhuji, and Mahaprabhuji is shown awakening Krishna. This is the first darshan of the day in the Haveli, also known as Mangala, meaning auspicious. Vallabha here sets the tone of Vatsalya Bhav, taking on the role of Yashoda in awakening Krishna. Raj here is envisioned as an alpine vista, cooling the hot summers of Vrindavan. This painting is actually done by Narottam Narayan Sharma. And if you see all these monkeys, this is the language of his preceptor, Ghasiram, which I will allude to later. And he also takes on this to mean Raj, or to denote Raj. This is an image of Yamuna Dashmi, where Srinathji is treated to a Naukavihar. Yamuna Dashmi is celebrated in the month of Jesht Krishna Vadi Dashmi. On this day, the river Yamuna is revered. The Vallabhans carried the memory of Yamuna to Nathdwara. Although Jesht Dashmi falls in May, which is associated with the hot month, all over the northern belt, heat storms are common and they cool the earth, bringing relief. Using Western imagery to denote the Yamuna, Krishna is depicted amidst the mood of Ghanghor. The dark clouds here are actually showing Ghanghor, or the coming of the heat storm, as we call it, along with his sakhis. And he has two sakhis here in the boat. In the temple on this occasion, Srinathji is dressed in white, very light muslin clothes, including a white pag, which is a headgear. The background, Pichwai, is also white, maybe lace or muslin. The spaces known as the Manikota and the Dhol Tiwari are flooded with water, and the Goswamis swim and perform Jal Krira for the pleasure of Srinathji, displaying Sakhi Bhav. To add authenticity to the tableau in the temple, aquatic birds and small boats are also floated. Now the next two images, number 13 and 14, represent the third darshan of the day, which is Gwal, of the day in Nathdwara, where Srinathji takes the cows to graze. In this particular version of Gwal, the artist has chosen for his inspiration the wash paintings of Japan. So can you see that there is almost an international connection that is taking place within the artists of Nathdwara? But as I have explained to you, that this international connection is coming via various popular mediums. That is important to remember while we go on with this. Has chosen his inspiration. This is a Japanese wash painting which has been chosen for inspiration, styling the landscape in the Japanese style, showing Govardhan in a squat manner. If you see Govardhan here or here, it's in a squat manner, and Govardhan Hill is actually a squat hill. Even the lotus blooms placed out here, which is again ubiquitous to the idea of the painting of Nathdwara, is in a very Zen manner, in a very minimalistic manner. The artist of the next painting has chosen to use a Western manner to depict the same darshan, with pink leaves on the trees and autumn colors in the background. All these are autumn colors in the background, if you see. This places the picture in the context of a season for the act of grazing the cows. So this Gocharan is actually, or Gwal, is taking place in the season of in the autumn months or in the later months of the year. So this is an amazing fact that this is an amazing observation that the artists made and added to the painting of Nathdwara, or rather the painting styles of Nathdwara. Now we go to another darshan of the day, which is the next one, fourth darshan of the day, which is called Rajbhog, or the midday meal that is offered to Srinathji. Here it is depicted as being shared with other cowherd friends, but under a banyan tree. See how the artist has been, although he has used Western imagery, he has been very conscious of using Indian foliage. And here he has a banyan tree under which Krishna and his friends are eating food, and a sakhi brings the food to Krishna. The artist marks modern time through the depiction of a bridge and a cemented platform. But the essence of Braj is maintained. Again, the device of the rhesus monkey that Ghasiram used extensively in his paintings to denote Braj is seen here. This painting is by Hiralal, who was a student and a compatriot of Ghasiram. Through these paintings, one can, this is Rajbhog, which is the fourth darshan of the day. Now we will move to some of the depictions from the Bhagavad Puran. And here we have the episode of Vastraharan, chapter 10, discourse 22, verses 1 to 38. And we are all familiar with the philosophical meaning, but what is interesting is the way Indic elements, like the ghat on the Yamuna, is blended with the Western background. So if you see these trees in the background, they're very Western, but here, this part of it is very Indian. This perspective is very Western, but this tree is very Indian. It's almost like a cheer tree. In Rajasthan, they have a famous tree called cheer. And this is very much the foliage of a cheer tree. And you have a ghat from the Yamuna or from the Ganga, from the Ganga. And that is where he has shown the cheer haran scene taking place. It becomes clear that the artists are using their agency to pick and choose motifs and employ them with due diligence rather than indiscriminately copying Western source material, which is the critical dialogue that has been available to art historians so far. Most of the colonial art historians have spoken of these as being derivative. But the more I research, the more I go into it, I believe that this is not true and that artists have actually used their own agency and their own purushart to achieve these scenes. The inspiration may have been Western. That is because they needed it for a Western inspiring audience, but not necessarily completely copied. We move to the next one, which is the story of Ras, which is well known. And there's a very interesting thing that happens in this, and I will explain to you as we go along. The story of Ras, or Maharas, as it's known, is well known. Before the Ras Leela began, the gopis had grown egoistic of their association with Krishna. And to humble their pride, Krishna disappeared after calling them to a grove, leaving them in despair and longing for his presence. In this painting, the artist uses the device of narrative gained from miniature painting. So you see what he does is he uses the narrative device on the same plane. The plane is the same. Right and left. On the same plane, he uses the river to break up the two episodes, thereby narrating a group of verses from the Bhagavad Puran in one painting. On the left, Krishna has reappeared on the far bank of the Yamuna, having disappeared earlier to make the gopis realize that pride will not allow them to attain him. This also symbolizes a distance between the egoistic Jeev and his salvation, which is Krishna. Once this message has gone through to the gopis, the Maharas commences here on the right, where he appears to each gopi, Jeev, individually and identifies with each of them as Paramatma. The next step, the next image is of Govardhan Puja. On the day following Diwali, Govardhan Puja is celebrated in Nathdwara with an annakoot as ordained by Krishna in the Bhagavad Puran before he lifts Mount Govardhan. So this is this episode is there in the Bhagavad Puran as well as in the Vishnu Puran. After stopping the propitiation of Indra, Krishna assumed the a gigantic form and appeared to the cowherds as the deity of Govardhan, consuming all the varieties of food that were offered. And in his child form, he paid homage. Here he is in his child form, along with Nand Baba, Yashoda, and the other Vrijvasis. And here he is in his celestial form, or rather his Purna, in his avatar as Vishnu. And he paid homage to the mountain. So a Giriraj Shila was carried to Nathdwara with Srinathji and is worshipped very much like a Shaligram Shila as a Swaroop of Krishna. Again, the memory of Raj has been carried to Nathdwara and is worshipped as a form of Krishna. Again and again, Raj and Krishna are becoming synonymous. And we will come to the conclusions. I'll explain it to you at that point in time. I'm sure you must have already come to that conclusion. I now turn to the popular leelas of Krishna, and this is what is known as Aankh Micholi. So I now turn to some of the popular leelas of Krishna, which do not have a mention in the Bhagavad Puran, but derive from the popular plays and iterant Ras Leela Mandalis. Here, Krishna plays Aankh Micholi with four sakhis. In the Pushtimar method of Seva, the year is divided into four parts, each with a special sevika. What I would like to postulate is that the four sakhis depicted here are Lalita, Radha, Yamuna, and Chandravali, who are the four sevikas. An interesting feature of this painting is how the artist has shown the bower in which the Leela is taking place as the entrance of a proscenium theater. So here, if you can see my cursor, this part is like an entrance of a proscenium theater. Artists from Nathdwara traveled to Bombay and to Ahmedabad and to other centers where there were institutions like the Marathi and the Gujarati theater. And they were influenced by these. If you could see, also, if you can see the backdrop here, it looks like a theater backdrop. If you see this pillar here, or this pillar, it would appear as if it is from a theater. And this is another act of modernity, or another act of agency that the artists bring into the art of Nathdwara in the later period. The next one is also again the peacock dance from popular tradition. Again, unlikely to be from the Bhagavad Puran, but the Ras Mandalis of Raj depict the scene where Radha and Krishna dance in circles with peacock plumage attached to them. It is very similar to the mating dance of the peacock and peahens. So we see here that the artists of Nathdwara had to contend with a preference for Western art with changing technology and tastes. But what was demanded of them was still the essence of Raj or Krishna Leelas. And this is where they bridge the gap by bringing in this new art form, which I feel has been done very successfully. And in conclusion, what I would like to say is that the association of the landscape with Krishna formalizes the space to mean Raj. The sampradaya gains legitimacy by associating themselves in mythic time and space, laying claim to Raj and Govardhan, even though their area of influence shifted. The artists were clearly using the influences in their environment to create a modernity in their tradition. Thank you and have a good evening, everyone.